Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. SpaceX Starship updates and NASA Artemis update. My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, and thanks to 1400 votes, let's dive right in. Starship updates. Anyone following my updates closely has noticed a steady increase in testing activity over recent months. By now, we've reached a point where there's testing going on in Boca Chica almost every day. Every day is a testing day. Under this motto, SpaceX has had tests again throughout the beginning of the week. Starship serial number 4 has to work double shifts right now, with pressure tests, pre-burner runs on Raptor serial number 20, currently installed on serial number 4's thrust pack, and static fires. Monday started off with high hopes. SpaceX had Highway 4 leading past the test site closed for yet another test activity, and the pad was cleared. Then came a long back and forth of pressurizing the tanks, venting, and depressurizing. It never came to the anticipated static fire, though, which still was needed for the 150-meter hop. As Raptor serial number 20 is a new engine that's never been mounted under a Starship yet, the static fire is needed to verify every system for a go-for-launch clearance. The reaction control system was tested multiple times again and seems to be performing well. Since there is no official word on how the test results are, we can only observe from the outside. An RCS thruster, though, is a rather simple piece of equipment, and so it should not really cause trouble. And finally, on Tuesday, we got our static fire for Raptor serial number 20. And it was a good one, too. It's hard to tell, but it seemed longer than the burns with serial number 18. Beautiful to watch, as always. Thank you very much, Mary, Rachel, and Jean, LabPadre, NASA Spaceflight, and Everyday Astronaut. All had streams going and cameras pointed at the site. After the static fire had occurred, though, a methane flame started burning on the outside of serial number 4. As you can see, it's a valve on the engine skirt. It must have been either leaking or it was just so hot that it kept reigniting itself. Automated water hoses started spraying the area with water with little effect for some time. A black burn mark became visible on the skirt. And the situation seems to not be resolved even until today. There were no tests since then, and the pad has been clear and the road closed for a few days now. One possible reason for this long closure might be that the tanks are still slightly pressurized, that SpaceX can't depressurize properly, and that it's just not safe for workers to approach the vehicle at the moment. It's unclear how extensive the damage is, but it's pretty safe to say we won't see a hop this week. I'll, as always, keep you informed. Follow me on Twitter to get daily updates instead of bi-weekly. This is a picture from episode 92. It shows the top dome segment for serial number 5, and there's something I want to point out here. Do you see these holes? It's hard to tell right now, but these could very well be RCS thruster outlets. The triangular alignment is typical for RCS thrusters and can be seen on many other spacecrafts. Here, for example, on Crew Dragon. Since reaction control systems need to be able to apply thrust into all directions and since the thrusters cannot gimbal, many of them are placed pointing into all directions. And that's exactly what we can see here. It's still just an educated guess, but it would be great to see SpaceX implement more essential systems on future Starship prototypes. The more of the systems are integrated right away, the more real test data can be collected. One step closer to an orbital flight. Sometimes it does feel really good to be able to say something for sure. Like in the case of this nose cone. Starship serial number 5 seems to have found its nose. Why am I so sure? Because of this little label here. Up close it reveals that this nose cone is thought to be on Starship serial number 5. Which makes this Starship the most advanced one yet by far. It will not only have a nose cone, but integrated reaction control thrusters, three engines, and maybe, just maybe, even aerodynamic surfaces like canard and aft fins. I would love to take a look inside of this nose cone. It might look rather simple from the outside, but it's pretty safe to say that this piece of hardware is not at all empty on the inside. Header tank, plumbing, COPVs, all sorts of components should now be inside, ready to be stacked on top of a waiting prototype Starship rather soon. The second test stand I've talked about on an earlier episode is almost done now as well. It's only missing the top ring, a place to put it, and the plumbing towards the fuel farm. Once done, SpaceX will be able to fly one Starship and prepare another one for tests at the same time. Hopefully, there will be many flights to come this year. Next up, we have another episode of funny descriptions on SpaceX ring segments. This one in particular is pretty good. I'm looking at you, Corey. Could you please explain to my audience what a taco dome is? Besides this thrust dome looking rather, well, not nominal in shape, it also says not for flight on the ring segment. So it puzzles me why the SpaceX crew in Boca Chica is sleeving this taco dome, even though it most likely will never be used. Is the taco dome a pathfinder for something even better? A burrito Starship? Corey, if you're watching this, please enlighten us. As always, huge thanks go to Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal, for taking pictures of these sometimes really curious sights. You rock. Cooper Hime took a few very nice pictures with a 2000mm lens on Monday. You'll find a link to his Twitter in the description. One of them shows a close-up of the heat tiles installed on Starship Sierra number 5. It's not known if these heat tiles are the final design, but SpaceX has been testing the hexagonal-shaped tiles for a while now. On the latest Starship prototype, we can see a whole array of them on the thrust section again. As you can see in the picture, there are a few differences here. First of all, a few of the tiles are slightly brown in color and others slightly blue. Then some of the tiles have holes in them and others don't. Last but not least, we have three different sizes: large, medium, and small tiles. The color likely is an indicator for different material used as heat shield. The holes are an indicator for the way they are attached to the hull. The ones with holes are attached mechanically, and those without are likely attached with an adhesive. The different sizes show that a Starship heat shield might either be built from larger or smaller tiles or in combination. For example, in places with round shapes, SpaceX might go for the smaller tiles to be able to follow the bends more precisely. And here's another great one from Cooper Hime's library. This one shows the hull of serial number 4 on the test stand up close. What you can see here on the side is a Tesla motor, and the setup looks like it's hydraulic. This could mean that serial number 4 might either test the motor under flight condition, or it might receive fins for ground testing. There's no official word yet, but serial number 4 seems to be more advanced than we thought. Thank you for sending me these pictures. Cooper, you rock. Finally, as of today, there are no test dates set. Today is the last day with announced dates. I have to make a little correction too from my last episode. Against what I said, there still is no FAA permit for a flight with serial number 4. So right now we're in a waiting position again for when the hop might be. And if you want to get more info about SpaceX's Starship development, details about what exactly they're doing, and lots of other interesting insights into Blue Origin, NASA, Rocket Lab, and many other launch providers and their rockets, I suggest you check out my quickly growing library of episodes. Here you can find tons of content about reusable rockets, SLS, the Artemis program, and anything else space related. While you're at it, do not forget to hit the like button wherever you see it, and please do subscribe if you have not done so yet. This shows the YouTube algorithm that you actually appreciate my work, and in return enables me to make more content for you. Thank you. NASA Artemis update. NASA is working on the Artemis program, and NASA wants to land on the moon. So far, so good. What seems to be more difficult with each month passing right now is when and how exactly NASA is planning to do so. So let's dive into the rabbit hole and take a closer look at what's the plan as of now and how exactly they are planning the operation. Artemis is the Greek goddess of the hunt, the wilderness, wild animals, chastity, and the moon. Artemis is the daughter of Zeus and Leto and the twin sister of Apollo. And that's why NASA chose the name for their next moonshot. Artemis is supposed to repeat what humanity achieved more than 50 years ago with Apollo. But it's not only supposed to make a few more footprints in lunar regolith. Where Apollo was meant to be a scouting party, Artemis is meant to stay for longer, or as NASA likes to call it, sustainably. For this, NASA had many plans already. Involving many different countries and subcontractors, the project does have the same scope as Apollo did. But where Apollo always had a straight course, Artemis seems to still be finding its way through a labyrinth of different ideas of how exactly to achieve the sustainability. Just recently, in February of this year, NASA postponed the Lunar Gateway, once an absolutely essential part of the Artemis program and the road to the lunar surface. Essentially a mini space station, the Lunar Gateway was planned to work as a stop for astronauts and equipment on the way. Where Apollo had a crew capsule, a lunar module, and a lander and was able to do the trip to the moon's surface in one stretch and return to Earth, Orion and its European service module have different strategies. There is no lander. So the concept was to get the astronauts to the Lunar Gateway on board an Orion capsule and then use a separately launched lander for descend and ascend. Since this involves an ever-growing budget, the US Congress decided to change these plans. Now, the Lunar Gateway is not on the critical path anymore and NASA is forced to find different ways of landing their astronauts safely on the moon. For this, private partners are brought in. Blue Origin, Dynetics, and SpaceX. All three are concepts that do not necessarily need the Lunar Gateway. But does this mean that the Lunar Gateway is off the table? NASA's primary mandate is to land astronauts on the moon by 2024. In a recent interview of Ars Technica with NASA Administrator Jim Bridenstine and Head of Human Spaceflight Doug Lovero, the official word was that the Lunar Gateway is still essential for the long-term goal of making the stay on the moon sustainable. I have to put a little update in here, as Doug Lovero has left NASA as of May 18th. So 1 week before the Demo Mission 2 launch, NASA loses yet another head of human spaceflight. This is not due to safety concerns for the launch though, and everything for Demo 2 is still on track. And NASA is still set to launch first parts for the Gateway in 2023. According to the plans as they are right now, an integrated Nucleus will be brought into a lunar orbit featuring power and propulsion elements, pressurized habitation, and a logistics outpost. And the agency made sure that this first module can be launched as well. SpaceX's Falcon Heavy would be able to send it towards the moon with an extended fairing SpaceX is providing as a requirement for launches for the Department of Defense. So the Gateway is still in the plans. What about Orion and SLS? Even though SLS was recently delayed yet again to a launch date not earlier than late 2021 due to a corona shutdown of the Stennis Space Center, the system is still on its final stretch of development. All major parts of the rocket, the service module, and the capsule are either ready for launch or very close to it. Right now, Kennedy Space Center is waiting for the SLS core stage to do a hot fire at Stennis. Originally planned for August, the test will now likely slip to around Thanksgiving and the core stage will then be delivered to Florida early next year. Orion and the service module, on the other hand, are pretty much done and ready for launch with Artemis 1, an uncrewed flight around the moon. After extensive thermal and vacuum tests at Plumbrook, Orion capsule 002 and the European service module are now back at Kennedy Space Center awaiting Artemis 1 and the launch in 2021. Artemis went through many changes to the plan and even more delays. Right now though, it seems like we'll see the first of at least three launches next year and a Gateway maybe as early as 2023. All of this of course if there are no further delays or yet another change of plans. Space is hard, especially if the plan involves several countries and even more subcontractors, changing politicians and administrators. Time will tell if other, straighter approaches will be able to repeat the success of government-run programs or if this concept will be the way to go for another 50 years. Sometimes though, changing old habits and going with a modernized approach can greatly improve results and speed up the process. Take learning for example. Where 100 years ago the Western world largely relied on a classical classroom teaching style, today's students rely on a multitude of different tools to speed up their learning curve, and today's sponsor has perfected this modern approach in a brilliant way. All their courses guide you step by step towards more knowledge and better skills for your daily work. Featured in international media and with high ratings from over 60,000 satisfied customers, they have shown for a long time that learning things the brilliant way can be the missing key. With content covering basic physics, math, orbital mechanics, or computer science, Brilliant provides a huge library full of storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problem solving for you to improve yourself for future goals. Understand your surroundings and become a STEM expert. Brilliant makes that easy, with interactive explorations and a mobile app that you can take with you wherever you are. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Learn things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It. How many Starship flights will we see this year, and how many SLS flights in the coming years? As always, tell me in the comments. And we're at the Patreon and YouTube member shoutout again. Almost 1 year worth of content, twice a week. We're getting closer to episode 100, and we're just a bit shy of 500 supporters combined on YouTube and Patreon. All of them pitching in to make each episode just a little bit better than the last one. A bit more research, a bit more funding, and a huge amount of support. And all of it given for the cause. That's why I do this shoutout on every single episode. It's because without these people, What About It wouldn't exist the way you just saw it for the 94th time. So show your love for them in the comment and maybe even consider becoming one yourself. And as on every single episode, there are new members on the team. Everyone, please give a warm welcome to Tom Krieg, Russell Tackett, Wollenschläger, Ron Fischer, Guillermo Rodolfo Klein, Jordi Fitzgerald, and many others. You rock. And last but not least, we're at the team shoutout. This is it, the final frontier, the last line of defense, and the core of the show. These guys work tirelessly to get you the latest and greatest about space and science. People of all trades come together behind the scenes and work with me on every single episode. Today's shoutout goes to Aaron, aka Another Space Nut. He's been here like forever, analyzing, crafting, organizing interviews, and keeping the morale up when another tank section blows up. Aaron, you rock. Thank you for watching this episode of What About It, and now would be the appropriate time to hit the like button, subscribe, and don't forget to hit the bell button to actually receive a notification when I do my uploads. It's a version of support that doesn't cost a penny, and it does help me to produce more and better content. And if you do want to spend your money, consider becoming a patron and get insights into the production of What About It and chat with me on the Discord. Or you could buy yourself a new shirt on our merchandise store and look like me. There are plenty original designs available in good quality for a low price, made by a space nerd for other space nerds. It all helps me to give you the latest and greatest about space and science. I hope to see you on the next episode. Until then, have a great time.
Prototype. it's the prototype.
Pathing right now.
Pathing.
Right now.
Snubbed up.
No. And today's sponsor has perfect.